with the body of believers you are together. Even in this weird way that we're worshiping, we are still together. If you haven't seen it, there is an order of service that's attached to the event. We also have gone to you an email a few minutes ago, and it's got lyrics to the music we're going to be singing together today, and you can follow along if you want. So welcome to worship. It is good to be with you. And as always, we're going to begin with our ritual of welcome. And with that, the lighting of our Christ candle. We light this light to remind us that the light of Christ shines in every darkness. And if you have a candle at home, you might want to light it too, just to remind you that the light of Christ is there with you. This light is not bound by time. It is not bound by space. It is with you where you are this morning, just as it is in here with us today. And in this light of Christ's love, I invite you to look around wherever you are. If you're fortunate to be physically with other people, look at them. Recognize the light of God in them. If you are by yourself this morning, think of the ones that you love the most and hold them in this light. And now in this light, we want to lift up our neighbors, the ones who lived nearest to us in a world that has often been so isolating. May we shine light to those who are on our right and our left, above us or below us, across the way. We hold them in the light of Christ. And now let us hold this light with any who we've disagreed this week. In this light, we are called to see beyond difference, to recognize that they too are created in the image of God and are loved by God. In this light, we look beyond the scope of people we know to those who live around us in our city, in our state, our nation, in our world. In this time of upheaval and uncertainty, we hold up into the light all those who are suffering or alone or scared this day. We pray the light would shine into this darkness. And I want to invite you now to close your eyes for a minute. Into your own heart. In a world that says we are not enough, can never be enough, or do enough, or have enough. In a world of scarcity and fear, we open our hearts to the light of Christ this morning. We let this healing light shine into our darkness, and we remember that we are beloved. Thank you. our dining room tables or our dens, we lift our hearts and voices in worship together. The Lord of love is with us all, and in that love we sing our praises. Disappointment, sadness, missing my friends. Too much to talk about. Yeah. Some of you maybe felt angry or scared. Some of you have been confused. It's frustrating not to know what's going on or how long it's going to be like this, right? I'm guessing a lot of you might have seen the movie Rapunzel Tangled. Have you seen this? Yeah. Remember Rapunzel? Yeah, I remember she was locked in a tower forever and ever and ever, and she would spend her time reading books and making art and baking cookies and brushing her hair until she was just really tired of it. Does it feel like that? Yeah. Well, I want you to know I'm really sorry. I'm really sorry you have to go through this. And I want to tell you that it isn't for nothing. You kids are doing something really, really important. Just by staying home and being bored and not going to school for a while, you are helping the world be a safer place for other people. You really are. All of you kids at home are like an army of superhero kids who are being brave and banding together to starve out the nasty, evil enemy virus. And every single day that you are home just doing your thing, you are actually helping someone else not get sick. That's pretty incredible, huh? So, I know this is really hard. Could you imagine someday, many years from now, when you're really old, like, you know, like, I don't know, like 35, And maybe you have some kids of your own or some kids in your life, and they come up to you and they ask you, man, what was that like in the year 2020? And you're going to have some stories to tell. You're going to get to tell them about all the books that you read and the stories you wrote and the blanket forts you made and how you got to join in a big, important job of helping other people be healthy and safe. And how you got through it.
And how you did type of church.
Yeah, how weird church was. You're going to have so many stories. Right now, I want you to know that you are doing your part to love your neighbor and make the world a better place. And I want to thank you for it. And know that you really appreciate it. And I am thinking of all you kids out there and your parents and praying for you every day. So we're going to get through this together, right? Right?
Right.
Right? Yeah. All right, you want to give us one last wave to your friends out there, and then we're going to pray, okay? All right. All right, you guys, this is a repeat after me prayer, okay?
This is a
repeat after me. Okay, well then you can sit quietly, all right? Dear Jesus.
Dear Jesus.
Thank you for the sunshine. Thank you for weird church at home.
Thank you for weird church at home.
Thank you for giving us courage.
Thank you for giving us courage.
And for keeping us safe.
And for keeping us safe.
We love you so much.
So much.
Amen. All right. You guys can go back to your personal, private pews. Got all your stuff back there. Love you kids at home. Mark chapter 12, 28 through 34, And 1 Corinthians 13, 1 through 13. Speak, Lord.
Your servants are listening.
One of the teachers of religious law was standing there listening to the debate. He realized that Jesus had answered well, so he asked, "Of all the commandments, which is the most important?" Jesus replied, "The most important commandment is this. Listen, O Israel, the Lord your God is the one and only Lord. And you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. The second is equally important. Love your neighbor as yourself. No other commandment is greater than these." The teacher of religious law replied, "Well said, teacher. You have spoken the truth by saying that there is only one God and no other, and I know it is important to love him with all my heart and all my understanding and all my strength, and to love my neighbor as myself. This is more important than to offer all of the burnt offerings and sacrifices required in the law." Realizing how much the man understood, Jesus said to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." And hear these words from a beautiful and familiar love chapter, 1 Corinthians 13. "If I could speak all the languages of earth and of angels, but did not love others, I would only be a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I had the gift of prophecy, and if I understood all of God's secret plans and possessed all knowledge, and if I had such faith that I could move mountains, but didn't love others, I would be nothing. If I gave everything I have to the poor and even sacrificed my body, I could boast about it. But if I didn't love others, I would have gained nothing. Love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It is not irritable. It keeps no record of being wronged. It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up, never loses faith, is always hopeful, and endures through every circumstance. Prophecy and speaking in unknown languages and special knowledge will become useless, but love will last forever. Now, our knowledge is partial and incomplete, and even the gift of prophecy reveals only part of the whole picture. But when full understanding comes, these partial things will become useless. When I was a child, I spoke and thought and reasoned as a child. But when I grew up, I put away childish things. Now we see things imperfectly, as in a cloudy mirror. But then, we will see everything with perfect clarity. All that I know now is partial and incomplete, but then I will know everything completely, just as God now knows me completely. Now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love." The word of life.
Write it on our hearts.
Write it on our hearts.
Oh, good morning, friends. So much has happened this week. It feels like it's been years. Apparently, I've gone from being a local church pastor to being an internet televangelist. So, you know, like and subscribe below if you like this channel. I want to thank Josh this morning, who's our neighborhood pastor, who's taken the lead on the technology to help make this happen. And Shout out to Jason, our facilities genie, who's gone above and beyond to get internet installed in our sanctuary to help make this happen instead of from our living room this week. I've noticed that every TV show that is usually taped before a live audience has just stopped altogether because it is too weird to do a show that depends on interaction with an audience to an empty room, and I am feeling that today. But we're not canceling, we're still doing this. So if you are watching live and you want to respond to something that I say or something later in the service, please go ahead and do so right there on Facebook. You can type in an amen, you can give a thumbs up, you can give a laughing emoji. If you normally like to sleep at this time of the service, you can put up a little, you know, snoring emoji, because we want to, you know, just be normal, just be yourselves. We're going to do the very best we can, and that's a way that you can participate and others can see your interactions as well. As strange as this is, I really am grateful for the technology that enables at least some of our community to gather together from our homes today. I came over here last night, and I was trying to finish my preparations, and I was here in this quiet, empty sanctuary, and I sat down on the steps here, and I just let I let everything that had been stacking up over this past week or so just rise up and spill over. And I just sat here in this room and cried for a while. I know you, many of you, have found ways to let yourselves do that this week too, and it's a good thing. All of the tension and the worries and the fears and everything that I've been holding for the people I love and for the state of the world just came out. And as I was letting out all those tears and looking around this room, I found myself praying for all of you. I can see your faces. I can see, you know, the usual places you like to sit in here. I can hear your voices, the sound of a normal Sunday morning with all of the friendship and community and life that is always in this place. And I just pray for you. You are a pretty great bunch of people. You already know the church isn't a building. You already are well practiced at watching out for each other in hard times. And you are people who don't just care about yourselves. You keep loving and caring our neighbors, whether or not they ever set foot in this space. And before I preach today, I'm going to preach. I want to give a couple shout-outs this morning. I want to give a shout-out to our Backpacks ministry leaders. They still manage to fill and deliver all the weekend food bags for the kids at our local schools. Who take that food home on the weekends to avoid being hungry. I want to give a shout out to those of you who in less than 2 days have organized a group of over 500 sewers who are making face masks for our local healthcare workers.
1,100 sewers.
1,100 sewers. That escalated quickly.
Awesome.
I want to give a shout out to anyone who's participated in the gift cards for school kids that our Crater Lake District initiated. That started out as $20,000 and it's grown to $35,000, and that's been distributed to low-income schools for their families in our Crater Lake Methodist District. And I want to thank our team of retired pastors who were helping out by making phone calls to ensure that all of our people have a point of contact and access to support from their church family, even if they don't have computers and technology to keep them connected. Another shout out to those of you who stepped up to help get groceries and run and get prescriptions for our folks who really need to be at home right now. And I am just in awe of the ways that you are all taking this opportunity to show love. I'm proud to be a part of this church. And I know that we're going to weather this together, even if we're practicing, you know, safe spatial distancing right now. So since Christmas, we've been working our way through the Gospel of Mark. We've been following the narrative lectionary. And today's regularly scheduled scripture was the first one I read, the greatest commandment, that we love God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love our neighbor as we love ourselves. And I also read the most famous chapter on love, 1 Corinthians 13, just to help remind us what kind of love this is, how powerful the love we're talking about really is. In Mark, we're at the point in the story where the leaders are trying to entrap Jesus with these tricky questions. They're hoping they can catch him in an offense that they can then use to take him down. But Jesus responds again and again with truth they can't argue with. And finally, this one guy, an expert in the law, wants to know if Jesus knows which commandment is the most important of all. And of course, Jesus does. And the scholar can't find any fault and affirms what Jesus says. And Jesus affirms him right back and says, I see that you get this, and you are not far from the kingdom of God. Understanding the centrality of love is what brings us closer and closer to the kingdom. We've heard this, and we know this, but there are moments on the journey when we start to get it more. And this moment we're in together, when this whole world is faced with this pandemic, this is a moment that will help us reveal whether we're getting it or not. This is a time when we find out if we really believe in the transformational power of sacrificial love, or whether in our hearts we really believe other things are more powerful. And we're just in chapter 12 in the book of Mark. Chapter 13, Jesus will go into a long, kind of depressing foretelling of hard times that are coming. Chapter 14, Jesus will eat his last meal with his friends, be betrayed with a kiss, be arrested, and abandoned. In chapter 15, he's brutally killed. So this is just right before all hell breaks loose and everything goes dark and sad and tragic. Jesus says with efficient clarity, the most important thing is love. People are complicated. We people can lose our minds a bit when we get scared. When that primitive, self-protective part of our nervous system gets triggered, we can do all kinds of things we would never do on a calm day in our right minds. You know, the disciples, they ran and they hid and they lied. No one on a calm day in their right mind buys 6 cases of toilet paper for their family of 3. The fear and scarcity and the fear that creates scarcity can send us quickly into a panicky state of me first and not you, and behaviors that are actually much more serious than toilet paper hoarding. Maybe you've heard about the racism that has been freshly unleashed on our Asian neighbors in recent days. It's been expressed in everything from interactions at the grocery store to national press conferences to physical violence and intimidation and verbal attacks. Reports of this are all over the place right now. Fear exposes and emboldens the kind of racism and otherizing of other people that lies barely beneath the surface of our society. Me first opportunism rears its head in times like this. People doing things like buying up all the hand sanitizer and then trying to sell it at gouged prices. When people get briefed in private on the pandemic and then sell off all their stocks before the news hits the markets. People behaving badly all over the place are making and will try to make a very strong case that love can't win. They will use power and manipulation and fear and hatred. They will exploit grief and profit off of human suffering. And we will be tempted over and over and over again to believe the lie that the main thing is looking out for yourself instead of loving and loving and loving, no matter how hard it gets. There will be Judases who betray with a kiss and who sell out their souls for a profit while real people suffer. So what about us? What do we really believe? Do we really believe in the power of love to sustain and transform the world, even in the face of these kinds of things? As so often, so painfully happens, I was given while I was in the middle of trying to finish this sermon. And I will honestly tell you that I failed. I had to deal with someone I wasn't expecting to deal with, whose attitude and behavior was, in my evaluation, rude, paranoid, judgmental, and reactionary. And with absolutely no sense of irony, I suddenly realized that my attitude toward this man was rude, judgmental, and reactionary. And I realized that it is so easy to judge back when someone judges and to react to someone else's reactivity. It's a lot easier to think, what's wrong with you, instead of what happened to you. And as I had this realization, it was humbling, and I thought, you know, here we are in these extraordinary times under so much stress. Do I really believe in the power of love in this situation? Can I let love transform me? And how will I lean into more love and allow this hard season to shape me into a better person? This hard season we are in comes with a lot of opportunity. I want to talk about this season for a moment. I had some emotional deja vu in the last week or so. That whiplash feeling, like everything just suddenly changed and I'm not sure what happened and I'm trying to catch up. It's a familiar feeling. As most of you know, it was about 18 months ago. Josh woke up on a Thursday, and within an hour, he couldn't move his legs. And it launched a season of mind-bending unreality. Every day was this deeper descent into a frightening, unknowable future. No one could tell us what was happening. No one could tell us how this would play out. No one could tell us if he would ever walk again. It was about 3 months into that experience, and a very wise friend gave us this metaphor and helped us understand what we were going through. And I want to share with you today because I think it speaks to the disorienting trauma that we're all sharing in right now. She said, you were going along with your lives, you were living in your universe. And one day, without warning, you were sucked into a black hole. And in a black hole, you can't tell which way is up or down. You can't see very far. There's nothing to orient yourself around, and you have no control over what's happening or how long you will be there. Eventually, you will come out of this black hole, but you'll be in a different universe. In the new universe, it'll have some things in common with the old one. But you're going to have to learn how to live in that new universe again once you get there. And on our personal journey, we found that to be exactly true. We've been able to mark our lives by when we found that we were out of the black hole and we were learning to live in a new universe with gifts and challenges, similarities, and entire new frontiers from before. And now in this moment with this arrival of COVID-19, with our whole world sharing in the midst of its impact, it feels like we were all going on in our lives in our regular universe, and we all got sucked into this black hole together. And we can't see the future. And it feels scary. We can't go back to the way things were. And that feels sorrowful. We can't orient ourselves very well when things keep changing. And that feels destabilizing. Being in a black hole means not seeing people we want to see, not getting to worship together in our beautiful sanctuary, not getting to go to the places we usually go. It's disrupted our routines. For some, it has meant loss of work and income and the pressure that comes with that. For some, especially those who are already vulnerable, those living outdoors, those with fragile health, those already barely making ends meet, and so on. It feels like just being pushed to the edge of a cliff. And for some, like those working in grocery store lines and all of our healthcare workers, it feels dangerous just to get through the day. And for those who are already grieving, already anxious, already running with a narrow margin, the stresses in this disorienting black hole just can feel overwhelming. It can be scary, it can be suffocating. I want to tell you today, we will not always be in this black hole. It will not always be like this. This will not last forever, and we will endure this. We are going to come out on the other side. We believe in resurrection, right? But meanwhile, it's still Lent. How do we live in this bizarre time? Will we grow in our capacity to love with the kind of love that transforms not just ourselves, but our world? When we begin to come out of this black hole, we will not be the same. Who we will be and how we will create that new universe depends a great deal on the power of love, the main thing. Every day, we get new choices and opportunities to choose love when we are afraid, to choose love when we are angry, to choose love when we feel hate rise in us, to choose love when we feel judgment wanting to take us over. This is a moment of opportunity to recreate our universe on the foundation of divine transforming love. And this opportunity exists on a global scale. There are opportunities to reformat our ways of being that have been destructive to people and to creation for a long time. It's an opportunity that exists on the level of every individual person to reformat our ways of being with ourselves and with one another and with God. I pray that we would see the opportunity in this dark black hole moment, that we can shine a brighter light than ever, even in the breaking. May we be broken open. 1 Corinthians 13 ends with the famous line, "And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love, but the greatest of these is love." Friends, if your faith wavers in hard times, if your hope seems to fade on dark days, be encouraged. Know that love is greater still. Love is our bedrock. It is the foundation that cannot be shaken. Love will carry us through the darkest night. Love will carry us through even the sorrow of death. Love is the power of resurrection that brings the sun to rise up after the darkest nights of the soul. Friends, may you bear all things, believe all things, hope all things, and endure all things in the power of God's unquenchable love. Amen. We're going to take a few minutes, as we do in worship, for some silent prayer and reflection. And And then Patricia is going to sing for us as we listen and pray.
My friends, this week has been weird for all of us, and I have gone from losing my grandmother, traveling in such a strange time, to home where I had to face my son, Cormac, who's a senior in high school, wondering how this will be for him as he was meant to graduate and go to college in the fall. And there aren't any answers. And we don't know how it will be. And I went to bed Friday night pretty heavy, my heavy heart. And Saturday morning I woke up with this song in my head. And so I wanted to share it for you today because it really lifted my spirits. And so I hope it does for you too. It's called Shine.
I look to you.
Well, it's time for the point in our worship service where we pray for one another. And Josh, who is on tech this morning, is going to lead us in our prayers of the people.
All right, I don't have a mic, but we're going to share our prayers with one another. You've posted some within the comment section of the feed, and we're just going to share those with one another. So, as we do in church, for prayers of concern, we'll say, for this concern, and we'll reply, Lord, hear our prayers, and prayers of joy, we'll say, for this joy. Thanks be to God. So here are the prayers that have come in so far. So Samantha Lise is asking for prayers for her cousin and her husband, who are small business owners. Both businesses are quickly going under, and she was laid off from her day job. They have already had to rent out their home to try and stay afloat. So for this concern, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayers.
And for all of those small business owners who are struggling during this time, we pray for them. And we pray for an opportunity for them to have some sort of a relief from either our government or some sort of support from our local community for this concern.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Tabitha Carson offers praise that her aunt Marilyn is home recovering from a stroke. So for this joy,
Thanks be to God.
Becky Schoen requests prayer for Doug and all those in care centers who can't be visited by their families right now. For this concern,
Lord, hear our prayers.
And for our Wesley family in in care facilities, including those at Willamette Oaks and other places, we pray for this concern.
Lord, hear our prayers.
And we can always be the answer to our prayers. If you want to reach out to one of those wonderful people, call our office and we will get you their phone number so that you can keep in touch with them via phone. Lori Bostetter requests prayers for all of our friends and loved ones who may have been or will be exposed, for strength of heart and body and all needed resources. For this concern,
Lord, hear our prayers.
Sandra Little requests prayers for the families and the teachers who are working to still bring education to our kids during this time. For this concern,
Lord, hear our prayers.
And for gratitude for those teachers who are figuring out how to do this, for this joy.
Thanks be to God.
Juliana Clevenger requests prayer for those on the autism spectrum who have difficulty when their routine is disrupted. For this concern,
Lord, hear our prayers.
Pat Rankin requests prayers for our unhoused neighbors and especially for her daughter, Sarah. For this concern,
Lord, hear our prayers.
Diane Prevenon requests prayers for her neighbor, Charlie, who is at home and dying from heart failure. He is a Vietnam veteran who has been through a lot. We pray for Charlie for this concern.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Carly Molinar requests health and healing for her kids and that we remain thankful and trusting for this concern.
Lord, hear our prayers.
And Christina Pickles is celebrating being able to worship with her parents 90 miles apart and celebrating that Dan got the job.
Thanks be to God.
Let me just check to see if there are any other ones that are coming in. Yes, there sure are. Kylie Nelson requests prayers for the Asian community here in Eugene. And Asian communities across the world that are experiencing an increase in xenophobia and racist attacks. For this concern,
Lord, hear our prayers.
Holly Simons requests prayers has prayers of thanksgiving that her mother's fever has broken, and continued prayer for her parents, Kay and Dan Moline, as they struggle with the caregiver, or without the caregivers they need. Mm-hmm. So for these concerns,
Lord, hear our prayers.
Kitty Pancake is just letting us know that we should not forget this is UMCOR Sunday and you can donate online. So
amen.
Donate online. Yes. And for this concern,
Lord, hear our prayers.
And for the joy of UMCOR in situations of uncertainty like we are in right now, for this joy,
thanks be to God.
I think we should pray for all of our seniors in high school. This is just a very particularly difficult time for them. This uncertainty is really shifting the way their future looks. So if we could pray for our young people who are in transition anyway.
Patricia requests prayer for all of those seniors in high school and also those seniors in college, as this is a hard transition as it is, and also just because it's a lot of uncertainty and a lot of grief. So for this concern,
Lord, hear our prayers. Well, as we do, I want to invite you to pray with me and with all of your siblings in worship out there this morning the prayer that our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, we're going to pass the virtual peace this morning. So if you are live, you can post a peace sign or say the peace of the Lord be with you. And I say it to you, wherever you are this morning, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. And while you are doing that, I have a little slew of announcements that I want to share as we start to wind down toward the end of our service. First of all, gardening is not canceled. Our Poppin Community Garden is going to be opening very, very soon. There are still some beds available. It's $20 for the whole growing season, includes water. This is a good time to have a garden. Our garden also needs some work. So if you are pent up and want to get outside and do something safe and also helpful, we're inviting anyone who can bring your own gloves and your own tools and come help us weed out our paths and around, not the actual garden beds, but all around the garden where the weeds are starting to take over. And that is a safe thing to do, just if other people are around, observe safe distance. Also want to remind you that we have this beautiful labyrinth that is available for you to come to walk. It's a beautiful way to center yourself in prayer. And it is available all the time, just right by our church, out by the garden. If you come and someone does happen to be there, there are places to sit. Just wait until they're done and then take your turn. For those of you who might need it, we just want to remind you that grocery delivery services are available from some stores. And we have folks who are willing to make runs for you if you need them. So if you need that kind of help, and you shouldn't leave your home because you're vulnerable for some reason, reach out to us and we'll find a way. You heard us mention the mask sewing efforts. Carrie and Holly Simons are heading up that group. There's a Facebook group. Over 1,000 people involved, many, many people sewing and ironing and assembling masks as a stopgap to help our medical workers. So that's an opportunity for you if you know how to sew. This next week, we're going to be I'm starting some of our virtual small groups. You can watch your email about it. And if you want to have a group that meets online, you want to talk, you want to pray, have a book club or a movie club or do a Bible study, we can help you figure out how to set that up and connect people to you. So let me know. There's going to be a heart math group and a book club group at a minimum starting up soon. So watch your email for that. Youth group is now online. Emily is leading all of our youth in weekly Zoom calls. They are reading a book together. And she's also offering youth yoga, which she said other people can join as well. So if you're interested, our youth group is still active online, and that's become a really important community. We have a needs clearinghouse at Wesley. So we're pairing up needs that arise with people who can help meet those needs. If you are in either one of those categories, please reach out to our administrator, Sue, in the office. You can call her or email her, and she will include you in that, whether it's a need that you need help with or you're available to help someone else. I want to thank you all for doing your part and staying home. If you need support, any kind of support, emotional support, reach out. I am here. Your church family is here. And we're in this together. And we're in this for the long haul. It is so hard sometimes to pick up the phone. But just do it. Just do it. People are doing all kinds of things to be creative and to spread good cheer and to keep us connected. And I encourage you to find the thing that works for you to do that same thing. Normally in this time of service, we would take offering, and obviously we're not passing a virtual plate, but I do want to say a few words about this. Finances are changing. We at Wesley are reducing some of our costs, electricity and paper and copies and things like that. But we want to continue the ministries of our church, and we want to keep paying our employees through this time, and so those of you who are part of Wesley, who've been a part of supporting us financially, and you still can, we just want to ask you if you'd be willing to keep doing that in this time. And that's for our, our overall mission and ministry, but also our very specific ministries. Today's Fish Sunday, so we'd normally be putting our change and our dollars in celebration of our live events to support hungry folks. If you normally would do that, I invite you to do it. We are still supporting our backpacks ministry, our wave ministry for veterans who are moving into homes off of the street. And it's Encore Sunday. If that is on your heart, they're providing a lot of relief for people. So I want to let you know we're working on a new website. Hopefully we'll be up by the end of the week where we can accept online donations if that is easy for you. But if you're someone who would normally throw something in the plate, we ask you to drop something in the mail or by the church and help us keep going. We will weather this together. And those of us who can't in this season, that's okay. Those of us who can, let us be extra generous. I want to thank you for continuing to support the mission and ministry of Wesley and our ministries, that we are going to do our very best to keep going in this time. And with that, closing hymn today, Be Still My Soul. Normally, I would give you a benediction, which is a sending forth, but you're already home, so I don't want to send you forth into places you shouldn't be today, but I do want to give you this little challenge. Instead of going to coffee hour, I encourage you, maybe find some cookies, and maybe call up a friend in this next hour to see how they're doing, check on them, and I encourage you today to take a Sabbath from the heaviness. Seek out light, laughter, fun. Find joy on this day to restore and bolster your soul for the week to come. My heart is with you. You are loved. Go love this world with all the love you have to give. Amen.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.